Welcome back to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio. Citizens United opened the doors for unlimited corporate money in elections. Because of that, we're left with elected officials that are completely obedient to a few billionaire donors. I have attorneys Howard Nations and Dave TeSelle with me now to talk about the billionaires' takeover of our democracy. Howard, you have now Sheldon Adelson that says, you know, yeah, I gave a ton of money, multi-millions of dollars in the last election. Some people think it's as high as actually over $25 million when you put everything together. But when you come right down to it, Adelson says, you know what, it doesn't faze me because I'm worth $30+ billion and I'm going to continue buying elections. Isn't that kind of the way of the future right now in politics?
It's the way of the present, Mike. What's happened right now, Adelson that you're talking about, he put $16.5 million into Gingrich's campaign against Romney for the nomination. When he lost that, then he put $30 million into Romney's campaign against Obama. Then he lost that. He put all kinds of money into the GOP Congress. He gave to the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. He spent $94 million alone in the 2012 cycle that we know about. Plus, with what he did with the dark money, which we're going to talk about in a minute, he's got a total of probably $150 million in this cycle, as a result of which they lost the Senate for what he was trying to do. They lost most of the races that he put money in. And he says, no big deal. I'm a poker player. I'll just double down. I just hope he's a better poker player than he is a political prognosticator.
David, let me ask you this. If you really take a look at all of the numbers, what it came to is you had, I think the number, it was something startling, it was 0.0011% of the U.S. population that really controlled the election cycle, because they're the ones that put in the huge amounts of money. 0.0011%. That is startling. Never in the history of this country.
It's absolutely staggering. I mean, what we are seeing is a return of the robber barons of yesteryear, where some elite few billionaires are basically making the decisions and changing elections through the use of influx of money, much of which is money that we can't even trace because it's anonymously given.
Yeah, well, now, with the 501c4 that we've talked about on this program so many times, they give the money. We never know who gave it or what their political agenda was until way after the fact. But let me ask you, we focus on Citizens United, Howard. There's more than Citizens United involved here, isn't there? I mean, what we missed is we let the federal government, with the Speech Now case, that actually expanded this. They could have stopped this. You could have had the FEC that could have said, you know, even with Citizens United, we need limitations. But we didn't even see the federal government on their own do anything to stop this, did we?
Well, what happened was the Citizens United opinion came out and set the table. And then it was followed by Speech Now versus the Federal Election Commission. They went into that opinion, into that case in the D.C. Court of Appeals, and they really just gave it away. And the result of it was that the D.C. Court of Appeals held that limits on spending unrelated to candidates violates the First Amendment. What that did was that said that these super PACs can raise unlimited funds, and the only restrictions they have on the super PACs are that they can't coordinate with the candidates or with the campaigns. So the federal government rolled over on that. They didn't fight that. They allowed that decision to come in basically uncontested and created, the result was they created the super PACs.
David, we saw, I mean, the best story here, there's so many great stories that really tell us how bastardized the election process has become. But I love the story about CHGO, is Commission on Hope, Growth, and Opportunity. On day one, David, they were up doing business, spent almost $3 million in political campaigns. They said that they were a social welfare group, that they were doing something to help on social welfare issues. They put the money in, completely political money. The day after the campaign, they disappear, can't be traced. We know, had no idea where the money came from, and it was yesterday's news, and the media is not even talking about it.
I mean, this is unbelievable. It is a group, the Hope Growth. It's a group that was opened up in the summer before the election for the sole purpose of raising money and influencing the election. They put, I believe that almost the entire amount that it raised was raised by one unknown anonymous donor. They then spent that money in the elections to influence the elections and closed up shop the next day. I mean, we're talking about super PACs that spent over $500 million, $567 million in the 2012 election cycle. This is staggering, and it's only going to increase, and this is not what was intended.
Howard, 501c4, I mean, isn't the real question here? Of course, now we have the Democrats apologizing for the IRS doing their job, which is outlandish because the IRS was doing their job. But this dark money that we see coming in, isn't there a way for the Department of Justice to say, listen, on a 501c4, you have signed off that you are a social welfare organization that does some political work. But when you have an organization that's spending 80% of their money in politics, we see it's clearly politics, they're not doing anything for social welfare. I mean, somebody had to sign that document that certainly should subject them to perjury or fraud kind of prosecution. Howard, what do you think?
Well, the distinction here is an important one, that the super PACs, we know who the money comes from, and they're out there doing political work. The idea of the 501c4, which is 501c4 of the tax code, this is a tax issue. And the majority of their work can't be political. It is the duty of the Internal Revenue Service to investigate 501c4s to see if they're complying with the tax code, to see if, in fact, what percentage of their money and what percentage of their activities are political. However, they've never defined politics. There's no clear guidelines on what constitutes it. NRA is a 501c4. And what's happened is that the only thing in the 501c4, they've become so popular because that's where their dark money is. In the 501c4, they do not have to reveal the identity of the donors. And the result of that, in the last 2 years, the applications for 501c4s rose from 1,500 to 3,400. And the 501c4s have outspent the super PACs by 3-2. So the issue of whether they are absolutely right to be investigating the 501c4s, the right wing, the Tea Party, the mistake they made is they can't target them. They should be investigating the Democratic liberal 501c4s also. Now, the result of this whole mess in Washington right now, the outcry over the investigation, is you're going to see more 501c4s with absolutely no restrictions because everybody's afraid to touch them.
Yeah, I mean, David, isn't that where this goes right now? First of all, you already have a media that won't report the stories because this has been a boon to them. I mean, you have the media with all these PACs rising up. Didn't the number of PACs double? I mean, just almost overnight, they doubled or almost tripled overnight. On a 501c4s, you had them go from about 1,300 of those 501c4s to over 3,000, okay? So the media is making a ton of money on advertising dollars. Why would they ever say this is bad? I mean, Howard adds to it and says, look, now the IRS is going to be chilled on even do anything here.
Absolutely. I mean, that's one of the biggest tragedies of the IRS scandal in Washington right now. It's the IRS who is tasked with the job of overseeing these 501c4 and ensuring that these are done properly. Now, it won't be protected by the IRS. The Department of Justice has done nothing to step in. And as you said, Pap, this is very important. It's the mainstream media that is benefiting some of the most from this, from the large amounts of money they're making from this. These things are booming. The applications are doubling and tripling overnight. The idea that in 3 years, super PACs have grown to control the money that's infused into elections and that are paid for ads and that build the coffers of these news organizations and networks cannot be ignored.
Howard, in order to even change this, in order to actually do anything that saves democracy to where we're not a billionaire, we're not bought up by a billionaire club of billionaire inheritance babies, in order to get there, obviously the federal government can't defend themselves. The media is not going to do anything about it. I mean, you have been involved in constitutional amendment fights. Tell me what the prospects are of that. How do you see that, especially where you have a media that's not going to help you?
There's not much that can be done because the Democrats and Republicans are in this equally. You've got the Car Row and Crossroads GPS on one side. You've got the big donors that have always been there for the Republicans and for the Democrats on the other side. The politicians are thriving on this. When you want to run for office now, the first thing you do when you run for office is you contact yourself, you form a super PAC. Even Obama, who was totally against super PACs, after he got beaten so badly in 2010 in the midterm elections by super PAC money, formed a super PAC, a really super PAC. And now, now everybody's in it. The president's in it. The Congress is in it. They're all in it. And this is not going to go away. Now you're getting the final thing on it is not just elections. Now you're getting single issue donors.
That is very scary because whatever the issue is of the day, the PAC rises up, puts a bunch of money into it. David, let me real quickly. We got about 40 seconds. Isn't part of the problem here with these super PACs, they're controlling the elections now. You have super PACs controlling elections, not parties. You don't have political parties making decisions.
You cannot get elected without these super PACs backing you and putting money into the election. This is what's happening with the Tea Party taking over a lot of the Republican establishment. The parties can't keep up. The amount of money that's being put into these campaigns by a few elite billionaires is changing the entire dynamic.
So ultimately what you have here is the parties are no longer making policy decisions about what advertising should look like. The PACs are taking it to wholly negative, and it is absolutely distorting the political process.
Absolutely.
Without a constitutional amendment, gentlemen, I don't see how anything is really accomplished. David, Howard, thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
Thank you.